because they had the moral high ground. There's only a few times in my life that I look back and I didn't have the total moral high ground, and I was just a, you know, run-of-the-mill guy. But the times in my life growing up in Dallas where, you know, one guy starts a fight, you beat them, and their buddies jump in, and then it's just you black out. And it's like, you're like, hear like a whistle noise, and it's on, man. And you know, the whole point is that you watch cops just enjoying themselves, sitting on this guy and bashing his head in the ground and hitting him with their guns and hitting him with flashlights and just beating his head completely in, and then still sitting on him after he's brain dead. And then being proud of themselves and strutting around his body. You got to watch the whole 21 minutes. It's such an act of intense cowardice that it makes you ashamed to be a human and ashamed to be a man. And if I was the average cop out there, I would be extremely ashamed. I said I'd open the phones up for police out there, but, you know, police are afraid somebody will hear them calling on the show. I know there's a lot of good police out there, but I'd like to hear from former police, current police, or even active duty soldiers. When you watch video like this, and then you watch the ensuing cover-up, does it make you feel good? And when you look at the way these cops look, I didn't see one Dallas cop that looked like a criminal. And I'm sure there were some that aren't good when I was up there. But then I saw the sheriff's deputies that were special hired goons. They all look like this, but bigger. And they have that look of they've got something to prove. They're not really men. They're not really tough. They're wimps. There's nothing worse than a wimp trying to be a man. I'm telling you right now, there's nothing worse than that. And I'm sick of it. And I'm calling them out at the base level of this sick cult that the police have become, just like every other third world country, of how they're above the law and they're great. I'd like to hear from police and military out there. 800-259-9231. We're going to go right to your calls after I play this. But 800-259-9231. Future cop says he's about to be a sheriff's deputy. Protesters should be exterminated in gas chambers. And then anyone that videotapes police should be basically killed. I mean, just amazing. Man shot dead at movies after texting by retired Tampa cop. I got another article here where, you know, the cop didn't like what was happening, so put a gun to a kid's throat in McDonald's. And you see these videos all the time where a cop will pull their gun out because the waitress doesn't give them quick enough service. And then they'll defend them. It's like the cops that came in Phoenix, or was it Tucson, and just for fun, pulled the gun on the clerk. Now, in that case, the police fired him and criminally charged him. That's what you're supposed to do, folks. You got some lunatic. You don't protect him. You throw the book at him. Because it's going to bring down the whole system. I mean, I'm here to tell you. The example of how police are above the law in many jurisdictions is just an example of what's going on at the top. So 800-259-9231. Let's go ahead now and go to a condensed 4 minutes of police officer's son. Remember that, cops? This can happen to your kids. I heard the Austin police chief a few months ago on 590 AM say, even if an order's unlawful, do what you're told and you won't get hurt. What if a cop shows up and says, come mow my lawn? Or tells, they've had cops pull women over at the topless bars and say, service me. I mean, you got to follow every, no, I'm not going to follow every order. The law and common law says that's tyranny. And I have a right to defend myself. Now let's go ahead and go to this incredible audio. And then we'll go to these police officers and people that are calling in. 800-259-9231. 800-259-9231. And then we're going to go into some of the other special reports we have, into some overdrive if we have time to do it today. But, again, I'm holding back playing this. Here is it from the beginning of the event. Here it is. You've got the cop with the billy club.
Well, hey, I'm sick of playing games. Which one is it?
Would you just... Hit pause. So they, and again, we've edited the tape. You can see the full tape. It's been seen by everybody. They just harass him, get his info for a while, start putting his hands on him. The guy's the normal response, pulling his hand away, saying, I'm sick of playing games. Well, the cop then grabs him around the neck and says, I'm going to hurt you really bad. Let's go back to the audio and video. Get on the ground. The guy puts his hands up like, settle down. But it's not normal when a predator comes up and says, get on the ground. But he starts getting ready to go on the ground. The cop doesn't want that. He wants to have some fun. He hits him with a billy club across the thighs. Now the guy runs. There's not a mammal on earth. You either fight or you run. And people are going to start fighting back, see? They want a civil war, folks. People keep trying to run because they don't want to die, like that woman in D.C. Let's go back to it. They tackle him. And of course, before the video got released, they lied about what happened.
Okay, dude. I'm sorry, dude.
I'm sorry, Lordship. I'm sorry you hit me for no reason.
Put your hands on your back.
I'm sorry you're on a power trip.
Okay. Put your hands on your back. Put your hands on
your back. Now they're breaking his arm. Now they're sitting on him, putting their weight on him. He's panicking in the pain. See, they do the pain to make you resist.
Okay. I'm sorry.
Just relax and let us kill you.
Dude, what are your rights?
Hey,
this guy jumps on top. Yeah, get a kick in.
I'm sorry.
These cops are all going to die of incredibly painful cancer. Their kids are going to die. Everything. God's going to cut you all down.
Put your face down.
Goes on and on. This is edited down for 21 minutes. This isn't really edited at first. This is when they finally get him to be knocked out. They're tasering him right now. And they call that resisting, involuntarily flopping. Taser him some more. Torture him some more. Oh, that moving. Gonna have to beat you in the head of the flashlight.
Roll on your stomach.
Roll on your stomach while we're tasering him. Land of the free, home of the brave. These are nothing but social workers with guns and badges and tasers. Daddy's not coming. Now they're hitting him in the head with the flashlights. Right now there's six police laying on top of him. Beating him and beating him and beating him and kicking him and stomping him. On and on. Now this cop gets his head. Knee on his head. He had bones broken all over his body. You ought to go read all the stuff they did to him. Get off me. Nobody's getting off you. You're going to go to the morgue, boy. Nobody's getting off America. Nobody's getting over the 56 million aborted babies. The Federal Reserve is going to keep printing money. America's going down. And these cops are going down with it. It's all going to go down. The radiation, the GMO, the curses.
Lay down.
They're never going to stop till you're dead, boy. Calling for daddy? Daddy came.
God help me, God.
God help you?
Please,
police are God.
Help me.
Nobody's going to help. Dad. As he begs for daddy, they intensify the attack. They love hearing him beg for daddy. That's the best part. Beg for daddy. Beg for daddy. He's never coming.
Help me, Dad. Help me, Dad. Help me,
no. He's not coming.
Okay, help me, please.
Let go of me.
Satan has you now. Oh, God. Nobody's going to help. The good guys are here. They're all standing on him. Now some more beating. And now he's going to jail. Huge pool of blood. Mission complete. Well, good job. All right, there you go. And, you know, I'm not trying to be sardonic there. I'm illustrating with the dark satire that this is where we are as a culture. And, again, we cut out a lot of the beating, a lot of the cussing, a lot of it. But it went on and on. And he submitted. They're the boss. They're in control. and they're going to walk. The two guys that did the caving into the head and the throat and the bones. And they're heroes, actually, in a war on the front lines. And don't worry, when they're all done, believe me, they're not going to be cops in the future. It's all going to be robots. Don't worry. Everybody's going to get a taste of this. I'll be honest with you. Kelly Thomas got out of it easy. The little kids they shoot up with vaccines with cancer viruses, they can take 3 years to die in excruciating pain. So, you know, these low-level psychopaths are just on power trips. They don't even know what they're doing. But the higher-ups, they're going to make sure everybody cries for mommy a long time. Because that's the music to the evil people's ears. Satan likes that dark energy force of the innocents being destroyed, crushed, sucked dry. So that was like Beethoven right there to psychopaths and evil people listening. Daddy, can we cue that back up? I'm going to go with these phone calls. Rob, Justin, Woody, Coffer, and others. We actually got police to actually call in, ex-cop, military ex-cop, cop for 16 years, 800-259-9231. But just as we come back to the next break, let's hear some of the calling for Daddy. Because, you know, I have a son, and that's a very painful sound to hear Daddy, Daddy, and then please God, please God. And, of course, God will come to our aid if we become righteous again. The police started grabbing on him and then hit him with a billy club. So he ran for his life. He had good instincts. And they killed him. All right. Who's the trash in that video? Let's talk to Woody in Washington. I'm sure you've seen that video. You just heard the audio. What do you think of that event? Was that a good thing to do?
Well, you know, the police stopped being peace officers back in the 70s with all the federal money that came into local law enforcement. Richard Nixon was behind that. And it was only guys like me that came on, were mentored by the older brood of real men into the profession. And what you have now is you have a reflection of society. And it's unfortunate. It makes all police look bad.
No, I agree. It is a reflection of the degenerate, cowardly society. Go ahead.
Well, I trained recruits for over 10 years. And you either had really good or really bad. There wasn't much in between. And, you know, here's a suggestion, Mr. Jones.
Yes, sir. Your radio's distracting you.
Try and put some good things on that the police do, too.
Look, I know that positive enforcement is better than negative enforcement. This isn't even about the police. It's about a corrupt system. And it's about people that who are such control freaks that they kill mentally ill people every day in this country because they don't follow orders. You see what I'm talking about?
Yeah, it's a lot of that, but it's also a lot of group psychology today. You have a thug culture that's infected our nation, and this is a reflection. The police reflect that. They're a reflection of our society.
I totally agree. The military is being taken over by actual gangs. I'm sure you know that.
Yeah, they purged most of us. They got rid of most of us, you know, not long after 9/11. So
I know. Listen, I've got a lot of family that are retired police, and they're just really great, cool, fun people to be around. Really hardworking, smart, good people. But they're all old men now. And I talk to young cops, and some of them are nice, but a lot of them are crazy. And they're looking for trouble. And as a man, I have the same response to them that I have walking down an alley when a couple thugs say something smart and you know, are thinking about jumping me. Do you understand what I'm saying? I have the same animal response to a lot of police now that I have to ex-cons. Do you understand?
It's unfortunate that we've sunk this low.
I hear you. Anything else? All right, I appreciate your call. Folks, try to turn your radio off or it will distract you because there's like a 15-second delay. Let's talk to Rob in Wyoming, former police officer. What do you think of stuff like that?
Oh, I think it's ridiculous. Absolutely insane. But for the times that we're living in, par for the course.
Yeah, I mean, so what if a homeless person runs away from you? If you're not looking for a bank robber, I mean, you know, just follow them down the street, pick them up in an hour. I mean, I don't understand killing somebody. Plus, the guy starts putting his hands up, and the cop hits him with a billy club across the thighs. I mean, what's he supposed to do, run or fight him?
I would try to get away personally. You know, I lost my job for basically standing up for the oath that I took. And I refused to participate in invasive procedures. And unfortunately, there's just not a lot of people that are willing to sacrifice that for doing the right thing anymore.
You know, the head of the Texas State Police supported them doing, without even probable cause, with the same glove, cavity searches of four cavities, two women repeatedly. Now, finally, there's been lawsuits, and they had to back off. But, I mean, that's scary when the state police are going to put you over the hood and put their fingers in you.
Yeah, I have a wife and kids, and I don't know that I would tolerate that very well if they tried doing that to me or them.
Well, see, that's what I'm afraid of, is that I'm getting to the point where I'm not looking for trouble, but at an instinctive level, I can't handle it. And I'm just praying that nobody tries this with me.
No, I hear you there. I absolutely agree.
What kind of stuff did you, I mean, you say invasive procedures. What are you talking about?
Well, I worked for a brief time on the patrol side of the house. And fortunately, where I live, we have a very good local police department. But I felt I was better in the detention area, so I worked in the jail. And when we got to getting around to doing the booking procedure, our sheriff had received a grant to operate a iris scanner. And I told my sheriff, I said, if I got arrested and you asked me to put my eyes in there so you could scan my irises, I would tell you to pound sand. So I can't rightfully ask anybody else to do that. And
by the way, so basically they let you go.
Oh, okay.
No. I mean, I'm asking what happened.
Oh. Well, actually, I got hurt. I got hurt protecting another inmate. And I wasn't able to do the job anymore, so they let me go as quickly as they could. But I'm pretty sure that there were some retribution involved over the letter that I had written regarding the eye scanner deal.
Absolutely. Well, I appreciate your call. It's just very scary to know that these juries, I mean, that's a reflection of society, are doing things like this. And again, they've got all these excuses of why they're doing this. But this system is a thug culture. We've got so many prisons that are colleges of crime, and they put nonviolent offenders in there where immediately, see, I wouldn't be recruited by gangs, and these were wannabe gangs, growing up outside Dallas in a suburb, and so they would fight me. I mean, I went into sixth grade out of private school, and I mean, I was immediately had kids that had flunked three, four grades beating me up. And I think it's the best thing that ever happened to me, quite frankly, in my life. It made me a different person. And the school wouldn't protect me. My parents said, well, you just better learn how to fight, which was a normal, old-fashioned way. I'm glad. I mean, it's the best thing that ever happened to me. It was, you know, I've been in quite a few fights growing up with thugs, but most people would follow the thugs, adopt their culture. And there was kind of a redneck gang, there was a black gang, a Hispanic gang, but it was, you know, join one of these groups, kiss our butts, or we're going to beat you up every day. And we're going to beat you up wherever we see you around town. And I just got to where, you know, these people are absolutely scared of me. And then I started having, by the time I was like 14, 15, to fight their older brothers and people that were like 20 years old, 22, were actual ex-cons. I mean, I'd be at a party when I was 16 and the door would kick open at some open house party and be some 25-year-old convict going, you put my cousin in the hospital, rah! You know, and it's like when I'm 16 and, you know, got later, I started kicking his butt and he pulled out a knife and, man, I just flipped the switch. And I remember saying, same thing with cops. Somebody comes at me with a knife, take him out. I have a killer instinct. I said, all right, that's it. And I know it's in my juvenile files up there. That case was in Rowlett, Texas. And I took that big old 250-pound ex-con. I probably weighed 180 pounds. And, I mean, I broke him up bad. And he never even came back from it. Last time I heard, he was an invalid. And I'm not even proud of that, but I don't feel guilty over hurting that guy because he pulled a knife when I started kicking his butt. And so it's fine to beat up a really bad person that attacks you. I mean, if some thug, you know, who's just stabbed somebody and you're chasing them and they pull a weapon on you, you know, they're fighting, you beat the brains out, well, fine. Don't beat the brains out of some schizophrenic that didn't even resist you. Because I'm telling you, I look at those cops. They look like the type of guys I used to fight all the time in Dallas. And let me tell you something. They're real tough right up front. When you start hurting them, they start crying and trying to get away.